A Letter of Instruction, by Joseph Smith III Part 4, 12. Could one of the counselors be so chosen by nomination and vote and preside until the vacancy referred to was filled? Yes. The rule of expediency suggested in the answer to the preceding question would be of force and value in this issue. The remaining members of the quorum of the first presidency would be persons directly in interest in the pending business of choosing a successor to the removed president, and the same propriety that causes a presiding officer to vacate the chair when matters in which he is in interest are being considered would suggest that neither of these counselors would desire to preside, under the circumstances governing in the case. If adverse criticism or opposition be made touching the work of these counselors during the interim between the death of the president and the convening of the conference, they should be left free from presiding responsibility, to meet such conditions free from other responsibility. It would seem safe to infer under such conditions that the counselors would decline to accept the duty of presiding, while the matter of succession was being considered. Not until the quorum of the presidency is reconstructed would the position of these remaining members be definitely ascertained, as they may or may not be chosen to succeed themselves, and the will of the body may otherwise dispose of them, as to their office. 13. Would it be considered imperative that such vacancy in the presidency should be filled at the next ensuing conference after such vacancy has occurred? It would not be imperative, but the rule of expediency would require that if such vacancy could be filled, in the spirit of peace and goodwill, it should be done. It would be advisable that the Church should know as soon as practicable who should assume definite control of the affairs of the Church, for if there should be friction, by reason of contention between individuals as to rights and prerogatives, an interim without the choice being made would only serve to sow distrust and disaffection in a wider field. In this as in many other things, precaution is the parent of safety. It is safe to presume that under the ordinary circumstances of church work, the conference assembly would be as prepared to act at such ensuing session as they would be at any succeeding period of time, and the risk of unavoidable difficulties occurring would not be incurred. 14. If not, would the quorum of 12 in their organized capacity direct and administer in the care of the church until such time as a successor was chosen? The office of the counselors as members of the quorum of the presidency not expiring until the quorum is reconstructed, they would continue to act as stated in answer to question 2, and the quorum of 12 justly could not take arbitrary control of the affairs of the church outside of their office work as a traveling high council, except upon agreement between the three quorums involved, accepted, and acquiesced in by the voice of the conference. If such agreement was reached and the quorum of 12 so installed, the counselors would at once cease to act, leaving the quorum vacated, as if their office as counselors expired at the death of the president, they could not hold office as counselors to either a president pro tempore or to the quorum of 12. If they did not exist as a majority of the quorum of the presidency, their identity as active officers would be lost to the church, except they should act by sufferance or by courtesy. Strenuous contention as to the rights and prerogatives would be out of place and incongruous under such conditions, and the Church has a right to expect that such will not occur. 15. Do the words, "Your priesthood hath remained with Christ in God," as given in section 84, paragraph 3, given to the elders of the Church by revelation, taken with other passages of Scripture and the revelations found in the Book of Covenants, justify the belief in the right of the sons of those acting in the offices in the priesthood to succeed their fathers who have been or are acting in offices of the priesthood? The clear understanding of this passage is that the priesthood had remained latent, hid with God in Christ, but the office in such priesthood depends upon the manner of call by revelation, choice, and ordination. Call, choice, and ordination presume worthiness, fitness, and qualification. 16. Does the law of primogeniture inure to the firstborn? Yes. The Church, however, is dealing with living entities, and the eldest living son is, so far as church work is concerned, to be considered eligible as the firstborn. 17. Are such first-born sons eligible to be chosen to succeed their fathers, other qualifications of fitness to act in the office being equal and satisfactory to the Church? Yes, without question.